Although I really enjoy textual studies and learning about the construction of text, repetitive words, recurring motifs, and the mechanics of writing, one thing, one approach to literary criticism that I find boring is the death of the author idea. It almost offends me. Perhaps because as an author, I put so much of myself into my work, and I don't think it is possible to understand my stories completely without knowing something of my biography. There is just my fiction is a reflection of my life. It is hugely autobiographical. So this idea of that one must remove the author from the text to so that the text may be purified, and that we can concentrate on the text as a unit that is unmarred by the sloppy biography of its author. It's really boring, very boring. And for me, it is false. It does not work. You cannot remove the writer from the text. The writer is the text. And this is especially true for me with H.P. Lovecraft. I read Lovecraft's fiction and enjoyed it, but I didn't become a Lovecraft fanatic until I ordered the Selected Letters from Arkham House. The first three had been published at that time in the early 70s. And it was reading the letters of H.P. Lovecraft that made me an obsessed Lovecraft fan, because of the personality as it is presented to us in the text of those letters. I found him delightful, fascinating, intriguing, and to the point where I began to echo in my own correspondence and way of writing the mannerisms of H.P. Lovecraft. Now, how is this tied to the Shadow Out of Time? Wingate Pielsley, no, that's his son. Who's the dude? The professor. You know who I'm talking about. I just have to find his name. I don't see his name anywhere. Oh, okay. My name is Nathaniel Wingate PLC. Okay, he has a strange form of amnesia. It was on Thursday, May 14th, 1908, that the queer amnesia came. The thing was quite sudden. The later I realized that certain brief glimmering visions of several hours previous, chaotic visions which disturbed me greatly because they were so unprecedented, must have formed premonitory symptoms. So he has this amnesia that begins in 1908. And during that time, his wife gets a divorce. In 1910, she obtained a legal divorce, nor would she ever consent to see me, even after my return to normalcy in 1913. I will not attempt to tell much of my life from 1908 to 1913, since readers may glean all the outward essentials. So, Pielski's strange behavior and such happens from 1908 to 1913. What does that have to do with the life of H.P. Lovecraft? This is fascinating. As a result, the period 1908 through 1913 is a virtual blank in the life of H.P. Lovecraft. It is the only time in his life when we do not have a significant amount of information on what he was doing from day to day, who his friends and associates were, and what he was writing. It is also the only time of his life when the term, quote, eccentric recluse, unquote, which many have used with careless ignorance in reference to his entire life, can rightly be applied to him. Accordingly, we know the mere scraps of his life and activities, mostly from random remarks made in letters years later. So Lovecraft had a breakdown in 1908 and was removed from high school, Hope High School, and it seems this lasted until 1913, exactly the time when Nathaniel Pielski, in The Shadow of Time, has his curious amnesia. I find that fascinating, and I do not think it can be construed as accidental. There really are very few accidents in the fiction of H.P. Lovecraft. He knew exactly what he was doing, and he did it brilliantly. He was a genius, but much of genius as, I mean, Laird Barron is a genius as well, but it takes more than genius to write really brilliant works of literature, as Laird Barron has, and as H.P. Lovecraft did. It takes intelligence and hard work, and it's a combination of things, and there are very few writers in our genre that have it to the degree that H.P. Lovecraft had it. It's the tragedy of this story. This wonderful story is that this was the first story that H.P. Lovecraft wrote in over a year. He was devastated by the rejection of At the Mountains of Madness from Weird Tales. And the tragedy for me of Lovecraft's life is that he could write a story that is so brilliant as The Shadow Out of Time and consider it not a success, and that he could then go to his grave with the idea that he was not a success as a writer. He wrote less and less in his later life, and everything he wrote seemed to displease him. He said something that he felt that he was farther from accomplishing what he wanted to accomplish as a writer than ever before. After writing all that brilliant fiction, The Shadow Out of Time is an amazing achievement. It is, many people claim that The Shadow Out of Time shows us the direction that Lovecraft's fiction would have taken in his later life, that he was becoming more and more of a science fiction writer than a horror writer. I disagree with that. There are not supernatural aspects in The Shadow of Time, but there is an intense element of horror. Perhaps the most horrifying scene in Lovecraft, and it is superbly captured in this radio drama from the H.P. Lovecraft Historical Society, of when he finds the ruins in Australia, and he finds the tunnels, and hears the eldritch whistling from the things that are in those tunnels. But some people, I think James Turner, in his Introduction to Eternal Lovecraft, was really trying to convince the world that had H.P. Lovecraft continued to live, he would have been primarily a science fiction writer, and his part of Lovecraft's genius is that he combined the genre. It was a very new genre at that time. It was just beginning of science fiction, and he was blending all the genres of science fiction, fantasy, and supernatural. But just before Lovecraft was just before he began work on The Shadow Out of Time, he had an idea for a novel, and we find this in I Am Providence, volume 2, page 894. By the fall of 1934, Lovecraft had not written a work of original fiction for more than a year. His confidence in his own powers as a fiction writer was clearly at a low ebb. In December 1933, he wrote to Clark Ashton Smith, "In everything I do, there is a certain concreteness, extravagance, and general crudeness which defeats the vague but insistent object I have in mind. I start out trying to find symbols expressive of a certain mood induced by a certain visual conception, but when I come to put anything on paper, the chosen symbols seem forced, awkward, childish, exaggerated, and essentially inexpressive. I have staged a cheap, melodramatic puppet show without saying what I wanted to say in the first place." In March 1934, Lovecraft fleetingly mentioned a plot idea. "I'm not working on an actual text of any story just now, but I'm planning a novelette of the Arkham cycle about what happened when somebody inherited a queer old house on top of Frenchman's Hill and obeyed an irresistible urge to dig in a certain queer abandoned graveyard on Hangman's Hill at the other edge of town. The story will probably not involve actual supernatural, but being more of the color out of space type, greatly stretch scientification." I love that idea. I've actually used it a couple of times myself. Shadow Out of Time is brilliant. A phenomenal success.